Well, it's almost 12 o'clock, so good afternoon and a happy Sabbath to every one of you. A hearty welcome to all of you to our worship service today. I was glad when they said unto me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." I hope you'll be blessed today as you worship with us on Zoom. So, a special welcome to those of you who may be worshiping with us for the first time. We tend to be on Zoom most Sabbaths. So, if you happen to be around and you would like to come and worship, please do come again. Let's say a word of prayer as we begin our worship service. We thank you, Father, for welcoming us before your presence today. As we come to worship, we submit ourselves to you. We pray that all the meditations of our hearts and everything that we will do and say today will be a blessing to your name and to us. So please accept our worship. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I have a couple of announcements before we go any further. So please lend me your ears for about 2 minutes. The first one is to remind you that the prayer events continue on Zoom every day. Now we have two prayer events every day. In the morning at 6:30 a.m. there is a prayer event so the early risers can come and join as we pray at 6:30 in the morning. At 6 p.m. in the evening, we also pray. So please do come and join either in the morning or in the evening. I also want to inform you that we will continue our reading of the Book of Psalms on Wednesday. So Wednesdays at 8 p.m. we meet again on the same platform to share the Book of Psalms. So looking forward to that event this week as well. My last announcement is regarding our brother Leonard Hay, who has been worshiping with us lately. Last week, we did announce the transfer of his membership to join the Cheltenham SDA Church. Following the church's protocol, today is a second reading. So, by this announcement, I'm going to invite those of you who tend to worship here with us, members of the Cheltenham SDA Church, I'm going to invite you to please vote now. Shall I say, indicate that you are happy for Brother Leonard Hay to be accepted into the membership of our church. Well, I can see hands have shot up already. Thank you very much. So you can vote either virtually by clicking the raising of the hand on Zoom, or if you want, you can also lift your hand just as I can see Chris has done. So I'm just checking the screen now. I cannot count all the raised hands, but I can see a lot there. Can I also ask by the same sign if anybody objects, if anybody is not happy that we accept Brother Leonard's membership? Can you please also indicate by raising your hand? I'm just checking to see how many I can count. So I couldn't count any. So by that, I would like to announce that we have accepted Brother Leonard Hay, and after the prayer event, he would formally be added to the membership of our church. Thank you very much. We will go forward now in our worship service with some singing. Today we'll be blessed by the Beamish family, who will be leading out. And then subsequently, Mike will also give us the message. So let me hand you over now to Robin, I think. Robin and the family who will be leading out in the singing. Thank you.
Thank you, Charles. We're going to spread the singing out a bit today. Normally we might do a bunch of three or four at the start, but today we'll just start with the one. Our songs will be kind of spread across the ages a bit in terms of when they were written. So there should be a mix, and hopefully you will know at least something. We're going to start off with something which kind of goes back to Vicky's and my youth. It's something we sang quite a bit, I suppose, when we were late teens, early 20s. And this celebrates all the names of Jesus. It talks about, you know, Jesus' name above all names. It talks about a beautiful Savior, glorious Lord, Emmanuel, God is with us, blessed Redeemer, living Word. And so it's only a short chorus, so we'll sing this one through twice. Okay, just switch devices now. We're going to move to something for the children now. So this is children, this is your slot. So I'm going to share my screen because I want to show you something that, well, tell you a story actually. So hopefully, there we go. So I hope you can see all that. So that's story time. And our story today is called Losing Our Way. And I wonder, kids, I don't know if anybody's willing to shout out from the flags that you can see on the screen there, which country you think this story might take place in. And if anybody wants to kind of quickly shout out. Okay, so I see that somebody in the chat has already pointed out, of course, that this took place in France, and this was something that happened to our family, and it was a holiday that we took back in 2007. So quite a long time ago when the boys were quite small. So let's see, I'm trying to get my let's have a look. There we go. So I don't know when you travel somewhere, what you use for finding your way about. I wonder whether you use one of these sat nav devices, portable sat nav devices that you take with you everywhere you go. Or perhaps you might even have, if you're very lucky, you might even have one built into your car, if it's quite a newish model. I took delivery of a hire car a couple of weeks ago, and it has one of these fancy things in, which doesn't bother me too much, but if it helps you get where you need to, so be it. Alternatively, some of you may still rely on the good old-fashioned Road Atlas book, which we do still from time to time. Or maybe even it's more primitive. Maybe you just write things down on a piece of paper and you take it with you in the car. So I don't know what your preference is, but these are all different ways of kind of finding our way around. So anyway, this is our where we headed to in France. You'll see the red blob down in the corner there. I don't know whether you can see my mouse pointer, but that's roughly where we were staying for our holiday. We drove down. We took the ferry across from to Calais, and we drove all the way down. Now we had a lovely holiday, and as part of our what we had pre-planned was that on the last day of our holiday, on our way up, last but one day, we were going to visit a wildlife park, which is kind of sort of not even as far as not even halfway to Paris, I suppose. And you can see Paris on the map there, but it probably wasn't even halfway to Paris. So I'll show you now. It's this red blob here. It's called Zoo Park de Beauval. And so we planned to spend the day there. But following that, we were going to go and stay the night in a hotel up in a place called Rouen, which is kind of not as far as, obviously, as far as Calais, but we thought, it would be a good stopping point. So that was the plan anyway. And what I'd done, I'd printed out some directions to get to the hotel. I'd looked it up on Google Maps, and I printed it out, and I thought, yeah, that'll be enough. That'll be fine. So anyway, we had a lovely day at the wildlife park, and we saw all these lovely animals. These are photos that we took. There's a white tiger, a jaguar, white lions they had. That is, remind me what that one is. It's a vulture. Yes, that's right. I keep forgetting these things. Lovely colorful fish, the koala, of course. And our friend the gorilla. So lovely day we had, and of course the day gets we ended up in fact staying we ended up staying longer than we anticipated, shall we say. And by the time we had seen all we wanted to see at the wildlife park, and we'd gone and got some tea and eaten it was coming up for, I think, probably near 8 o'clock in the evening. And yet we still had, and this is the map, look, that's where the wildlife park is. And up in the top left-hand corner of the map, that's where we had to get to for our night's stay before pushing on for the ferry at Calais the following day. Now, by the time we actually got to Rouen, it didn't look like this at all. It was pitch black because it was around about midnight. And of course, we'd never really been to Rouen before. And so the streets possibly looked just a little different to what we'd hoped they might look like. And at that particular time, the Google map instructions that I printed off perhaps didn't quite make the same amount of sense as I thought they would. And Vicky has reminded me that perhaps I should have taken some more detailed instructions, or even had a map, you know, a good old fashioned map. So I'm just having a look. So you see, I had all of this on what I had on the left. I had there, I had some printed instructions off Google, but I had nothing by way of a proper map for us to find our way about. And so you imagine we arrived in Rouen about midnight, hoping that it wouldn't, and thinking it wouldn't take long to find this hotel. Well, how wrong was I? Because we spent the next 2 hours circling around Rouen, getting completely lost. And eventually we gave up because we weren't finding our hotel at all. And the long and the short of it was that we ended up getting back on the French motorway, the autoroute, heading to the nearest service station. And just we slept, or tried to sleep, in the car for the next few hours. Unfortunately, it was not very comfortable. And I don't think any of us, and the boys being 8 and 6, or nearly 9 and 6, and we couldn't really get them into a comfortable seat because there was loads of luggage packed around them. And so there, that was our night's accommodation, and all because I hadn't really done the due preparation and looked up and got the proper directions which would have got us to our planned destination. Now, I'd like to suggest to you that it's a bit the same in life. And really, as Christians, we need to rely on the Bible to help us find our way properly. The Bible is our roadmap, if you like, for helping us through lots of different things. And you know, we come across lots of different challenges. And so I would encourage you to use your Bibles to help you meet the challenges that come every day. And the verse that immediately sprang to mind, it's this one at the bottom here. It says Psalm 119, verse 105. Many of you might know that, but just to be absolutely sure, it says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." And so when you're going through the midnight of life, when things don't seem very clear, this is the Bible is your route map. It's your lamp, and it helps you to find your way when things don't seem so good. So I want you to remember that, boys and girls, and adults as well. Don't forget, so that we know and we can be confident as we make our way through life. We're now going to sing a couple more songs. So I'm just going to stop sharing and we'll get to our stations for singing again.
Mike's just been talking to you. Is my sound on properly?
Yeah.
Mike's just been talking to you about how the Bible is our guide. And to be able to have that as our guide, we need to read it. And we need to read it and pray every day. So we're going to do some actions. I'm going to take my microphone off the stand so I can do them. Because for this one, you need to start standing up and then crouch down small. So you crouch down small and you grow as we sing. Read your Bible, pray every day as you grow, grow, grow. And we'll keep growing all the way through the verse. So, are you ready?
Read your Bible, pray every day, pray every day, pray every day. Read your Bible, pray every day, and you'll grow, grow, grow. And you'll grow, grow, grow. And you'll grow, grow, grow. Read your Bible, pray every day, and you'll grow, grow, grow. Leave your Bible, forget to pray, forget to pray, forget to pray. Leave your Bible, forget to pray, and you'll shrink, shrink, shrink. And you'll shrink, shrink, shrink. And you'll shrink, shrink, shrink. Leave your Bible, forget to pray. And you'll shrink, shrink, shrink. Read your Bible, pray every day. Pray every day, pray every day. Read your Bible, pray every day, and you'll grow, grow, grow. And you'll grow, grow, grow. And you'll grow, grow, grow. Read your Bible, pray every day, and you'll grow, grow, grow.
Okay, we're going to sing another song now, one which we have taught you a few times, I think over the last few months. It's a relatively new song, and I think it's one which is one we can all relate to regardless of our age, and it talks about, if doesn't matter what we're feeling like, if we're fearing, or if we're feeling weak, or if we thirst, we can come to Jesus because he is strong and kind. So if you don't know it, don't worry. I think by the time we get to maybe even the second verse, you should pick it up. But if you do know it, do sing along, because it's such a lovely song.
Jesus said that if I thirst, I should come to him. No one else can satisfy, I should come to him. Jesus said if I am weak, I should come to him. No one else can be my strength, I should come to him. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and Jesus Jesus said that if I fear, I should come to Him. No one else can be my shield, I should come to Him. For the Lord is good and faithful, He will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and kind. Jesus said, if I am lost, He will come to me. And He showed me on that cross, He will come to me. For the Lord is good and faithful, He will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and
good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. Today I will be reading from 1 Corinthians 9, verse 19 to 23. And it reads, though I am free and belong to no one, I have made myself a slave to everyone, to win as many as possible. To the Jews I became like a Jew, to win the Jews. To those under the law I became like one unto the law, though I myself am not under the law, so as to win those under the law. Verse 21, to those not having the law I became like no one, not having the law, though I am not free from God's law, but I am under Christ's law. So as to win those not having the law, to the weak I became weak, to win the weak. I have become all things to all people, so that by all possible means I might save some. I do all this for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in its blessings. May the Lord add a blessing to this word.
Before we enter into a time of prayer, we're going to share a song together, which I think is fitting, where the song invites us to ask God to purify our hearts and to perhaps look inside us and for God to make us clean. So we're going to sing together now, purify my heart.
Mike and the team. It's now time for us to share and talk to God in prayer. So as we normally do, it's time for you to please unmute yourself or write out in the chat anything that you would like to share as per your life. Is there something that God has done? Is there something that you're looking forward to that you would like to share now before we bring ourselves together in prayer?
Hi, Charles.
Hello.
So I had a job interview yesterday, which was quite interesting. I'm very keen on the job. I had quite a long conversation with the guy who was interviewing me about the Sabbath, because I bring it up at every job interview. And it was quite interesting. I think he thought it could possibly be a slight issue, but sounded like he was willing to look at a way that it could be accommodated. So I guess I want to pray that if if this is where God wants me to be, that he'll open doors, but ultimately that what I said will make a difference.
Okay, we'll pray. Robin, yeah, Archie?
I'd like to pray for the people of that are having a famine and drought in Madagascar, because I heard about it on the radio.
Okay, I don't know if you heard Archie, but he heard that people are having drought and famine in Madagascar. So he would like us to remember the people of Madagascar in our prayer.
Charles, if I could add something. I don't know, I think for all of us, sometimes we experience those, I think Pastor James would call it God moments in our lives. A few weeks ago, as some of you will know, I started a new job. And it's amazing how God puts people together. I had a handover for a project that I'm now working on, and I discovered that the guy who is doing the handover, he is a Christian, and also I believe his wife grew up as an SDA. In actual fact, I hope Lawrence doesn't mind me saying so, but I believe they're on the meeting this morning, and I just want to say thank you to God for Lawrence and for the way he's kind of helped me through the first few weeks, and also for the kind of faith conversations we've been able to have. And I just want to kind of say a personal thank you to Lawrence for all his help. So thank you Lawrence, and thank you God for bringing people together.
Okay, it will be wrong if I don't share this as well. Last week, Wednesday, when I woke up, I didn't feel quite right. I wasn't in myself because I didn't sleep well on the Tuesday night. So, because of the work I do, I have to do regular COVID tests anyway. So I was looking forward to my test on Wednesday morning, kind of preempting that maybe something is wrong. And well and truly, it was wrong. I did the test and it came out as positive. I didn't really believe it. So I did it again. So I had two double positives on Wednesday morning. I wasn't ill as such, but then I had to change my plans and teach online. It started worrying me a bit. I wasn't ill physically, but Ernestina is away and I'm with the kids. So started thinking, wow, am I really going to get ill, and how will things pan out? There was a God moment. So I just opened my heart and said, hey, what's going on here? Anyway, to cut the long story short, I was kind of looking forward to be ill, which didn't quite materialize. I was all right on Thursday. I did work. I worked on Friday. Saturday, I came to church. I did a test on Saturday. It was still positive. I didn't do it on Sunday. But then I did it again on Monday. It was negative first on Monday. And I did it again on Tuesday, and it was negative. Yesterday, Mike reminded me that two negatives constitute a positive. So, I'm just thanking God. I sounds like I'm making taking it very lightly, but not at all. I know when people have had COVID, sometimes it's been a lot more challenging, and mine was a bit easier. So I'm thanking God, and I think it will be right when we pray to remember people who haven't had it easy. So when I went back to work on Wednesday, I met a colleague who I'll be praying for, and I do ask that you pray for him as well. He is kind of suffering from long COVID. He had it last year, and Vassel is the name. He still hasn't returned to his normal self, and I will continue praying for him because he was like, well, Charles, you're lucky, right? It was just 5 days for you. I've had it, he said, for more than 6 months, and I'm still struggling. And there are many of such people that I think we will have to remember in our prayer. I think there's something in the chat as well. Just checking. Thanking God for celebration of another birthday and wedding anniversary. Ah, Odette. Ah, okay. Brilliant. Good news there. So please, I will invite you now to join me as we pray. Ellen White reminds us that prayer is the opening of the heart to God as to a friend. Not that it's necessary in order to make known to God what we are, but in order to enable us to receive him. Prayer does not bring God down to us, but brings us up to him. So as we ponder up over those words and the testimonies we have heard, please, let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we come to you again this Sabbath day with hearts that are flowing with gratitude. We are very happy that we can call you Father, because that is who you are. When we sang this morning, we sang about how amazed we are about the relationship we have with you, for the wonderful way that you father us. Because your love is so beautiful. You provide for all our needs. You care for us. And when we are not even aware, you are there. You're always doing things that amaze us. You open doors that seem shut. You bring us into new relationships. You give us new friends. When we have not been well, you heal us. When we feel the pain, you feel it with us. So we thank you. We mean it when we say thank you for all the things that you continue to do for us. Father Lord, when we have gone wrong, we have to come back to you and ask that you forgive us. And on this occasion, we know we have done things that are wrong. Sometimes we've done them because we couldn't just figure it out, the best way to act. Sometimes we have even done it intentionally. For all our sins, we pray that you forgive us and that you will accept our worship and our offerings today. Lord, as at this time, there are things which are on our hearts that we open out to you. You know what Robin said? He's looking for a new job. You've done it before, and your word says that you are the type of father who will not give us things that we don't need or things that will not be good for us. But you know what's good for us, and you will always give it to us in abundance. So, Father, if it's your will, please open this job door opportunity for Robin, and let it be his. We likewise pray for friends and family who are not well, some of whom are really still suffering from COVID and other ailments. Healing comes from only you, Lord. So we pray your healing on all the sick. We also pray, Lord, that today as we prepare ourselves for your message that will be given by Mike, that, Lord, you give him the words to speak to us and give us the understanding that we need. Above all, Lord, you know our needs, so we pray that you bless us today and forevermore, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Before we have our message time together, we're going to sing one more song, and it's really inviting God through His Spirit to have His own way in our lives and in our understanding. We're going to sing the kind of well known hymn to most of us. We know it to the title of Have Thine Own Way, but if you don't mind, just for today, what I've done is I've changed the pronouns, okay, so that the pronouns are such that we understand them in the way that we would speak today. So hopefully you'll follow it, but it's the same tune, and we're just inviting God to have His own way.
I am the clay.
Sorry, I was on mute. Yeah, I'm really glad to be with you this morning to have the opportunity of sharing with you. I hope it will be a benefit to us all, and it may be challenging, but I hope you don't mind the challenge. So I just pray that we will all be blessed and challenged at the same time as we share together. For the first few minutes this morning, what I would like to do is to share a PowerPoint screen with you. So if you will just bear with me for a second while I get the... That's my title for this morning. It's called Changing Our Mind Maps, maybe that'll start you thinking, what on earth is he going to be talking about this morning? We'll find out all in good time. But just as a kind of a gentle warm-up to the message that I want to get across this morning is, maybe you want you to think about, particularly in Cheltenham, and if you're not from Cheltenham, but you're from somewhere else, to have a think about, where are you, if someone were to ask you, well, where are our local churches, where would you say church is in Cheltenham? And particularly maybe we might say in West Cheltenham, because that's where we are. So, you know, I've picked out some here, which some you recognise, some you won't. This, of course, is C3, which is a venue that we've hired out several times and had some wonderful events there. And I think universally, I think people have really enjoyed worshipping there when we have. So that's just round the corner from St Mark's School, where we normally worship. So lovely facility there. This is another one, Hester's Way Baptist Church, which is kind of heading across towards the Springbank area, which is, of course, where we've focused a lot of our Messy Church efforts in. Okay, this is another one you'll recognise, St Mark's Methodist, which is, again, where we've hired the facility out for some very memorable days. Again, a lovely facility to use. That's another St Mark's church, but this is the St Mark's C of E church, which is just heading in towards the railway station a bit. So big old church. I've never been inside there, but passed it many times. This is St Barnabas Church, which for those of you who know West Cheltenham quite well, it's just off Princess Elizabeth Way. And I know they're quite active also there. And then lastly, this is St Thomas More Catholic Church. This is situated again on the edge of sort of the Springbank estate, and there is also an associated school. So these are some of our churches in Cheltenham, and in particular our relevant area, I guess. So you may think of others, but I want to ask you a question this morning. What if a church were to look very different to this? Could it be that church is not just as we might think it is? And this is where I'm wanting you to start thinking about your mind maps. Your mind maps, when I asked you about churches and where you thought they were, you would have probably thought immediately about some of these buildings that I showed you just now. This is a book that I've been reading, I'm still reading at the moment, by a chap called Steve Aisthorpe. He's not an Adventist, but he is a very committed Christian. He's been doing a lot of research into what Christianity actually looks like in the UK, and we went to an online seminar of his. I'm trying to think now, maybe nearly two years ago, perhaps. I'm trying to think now, but anyway, we went along out of interest, and his experiences and his research are very telling. And so, and this is a snapshot, a little picture out of the very beginning of his book. You know, what if church were to look a bit like this, where church doesn't actually just happen in a church building? What if it happens in people's houses? Maybe meetings in office blocks, in the park somewhere. You know, what happens? What about those people who meet elsewhere, apart from in a church building? Well, actually, according to Steve Aisthorpe's extensive research, this is where church is actually happening, and it does actually look quite a bit like this at times, in fact, for some people. And if that's so, if this is happening, what might be the implications for us here in Cheltenham, in the here and now, and in the time in which we live? Okay, I'm going to stop sharing my screen just now. So what does all this mean? Okay, well, I think there's one thing we can say, first of all, is that if there are other Christians out there who are not part of a church denomination or a church congregation, what that means in possibly is that perhaps this is good news, that, you know, the Christian faith may be more alive than we think. You know, if there are a substantial number of practicing Christians who are not choosing to affiliate themselves with any congregation, there are many people who rely on statistics, aren't there? And I must admit, I'm possibly one of them some of the time, where, you know, we think, oh, church attendance is going down, it's going down, and maybe it has gone down, but maybe this research is kind of suggesting to us that perhaps it may not be as down as we think it is. So that's possibly some good news, isn't it? Okay, but with that also comes challenges, doesn't it? This knowledge, this discovery that perhaps church is happening elsewhere other than in a church building either on a Saturday or a Sunday morning. The first challenge is that we need to accept that there are now very different ways of doing and being church. It's not about, for us, maybe even, you know, do we have to meet in St. Mark's on a Sabbath morning? Do we even have to be on Zoom on a Sabbath morning to be and do church? Can we or should we expect to be filling up our places of worship when people are finding meaningful other ways of living out their Christian faith? And this is the kind of thing that the author of the book is very much bringing to our attention, that people are their faith is not diminishing just because they are not part of a church group. They're not necessarily backsliding, like we might think they may be. They are very active. There are people out there who are active in their faith, but they have just chosen not to be part of a church denomination or a church congregation even. Maybe in the light of these findings that some Christians genuinely have become disillusioned and disheartened with established church congregations, or they've just found that church as we know it just doesn't suit some people. Is it not then about time we asked ourselves some questions, maybe as a church, as to whether we are being the relevant type of church to our communities that are around us? Do we know what they need? Will their needs be met by the way we are being church right now? Is it possible that instead of trying to get everybody back to the school for our regular services of, you know, in the past we had 50 plus on a Sabbath morning, didn't we? That maybe God through COVID is calling us to being a different kind of church, or churches maybe, which could be way more effective in making disciples and building communities. And I'm using that, that's the mantra from our South England conference. That's their mission statement: make disciples and building communities. Does it mean that there are other ways that we could be doing that right now? Let's consider the early church of Acts, which is something I like to go back to time and time again. The growth was phenomenal, wasn't it? We read about the numbers of thousands being added to the faith. But what we don't appear to find is massive congregations necessarily. We don't hear about these big mega churches, but what we do hear about is households of faith, smaller groups of believers who met where? In homes. They kept things simple, didn't they? And I know I keep going back to it, but at the end of Acts chapter 2, what were the simple things they did? They shared the word together, they ate together, they were glad together, and they shared their possessions to those who had need. In other words, they were being community, weren't they? But it also tells us something really important towards the end of chapter 2. It says that they enjoyed the favor of all the people. So along with the driving force of the Holy Spirit, this is what led to phenomenal growth. And the phenomenal growth wasn't in the big churches. So there was no kind of, from the way I read it, no structured church with structured church services, church boards, nominating committees, endless committee meetings, plus much more in our traditions. And yes, dare I say it, we even have our rituals, don't we? And I do feel on a personal level, we lose a lot in all of this. All Jesus asked us to do in Matthew 28 was to go and make disciples. Yet our mind maps have turned church into so much more and made it so complicated for us to actually go and make disciples effectively. I'd like to just share with you a brief excerpt from the book. It's a story that that the author shared with his readers, and see if we can't learn something from this. He writes, and this book was written perhaps a few years ago, so you can kind of gauge this for yourselves. About 25 years ago, I went with a small group of friends on a mountaineering expedition to Peru. A couple of days' walk from a remote village, we established a base camp encircled by awe-inspiring mountains. Spectacular hanging glaciers tumbled down towards turquoise lakes. Herds of alpacas, Peru's diminutive woolly llamas, grazed the foothills around the camp. Over the next few days, we explored the surrounding mountains and valleys, acclimatizing to the rarefied air, and prospecting for potential peaks to climb. We had a map. Now, remember, in the children's story, I didn't have a map, did I? We had a map, but frustratingly, time and time again, we found that what it depicted and what reality presented were two quite different things. Lakes which should have been there, that shouldn't have been there, definitely were. A river seemed to take a radically different course from the one portrayed on the map. In the dispute between map and reality, there was only ever going to be one winner. Reality trumps the map every time. We subsequently discovered that some years earlier, an earthquake and associated landslides and avalanches had resulted in some significant changes to the terrain. Reality was right. The map was wrong. It needed updating. Okay, I don't know what you think about that. Quite interesting, isn't it? I think that would unnerve me if I was in their position. One thing I want you to note, and this I think we can draw a few parallels here, is to note that the reality was different to the map. It's quite possible that the mind's map of God's church that we would like to present to our communities is very different to the reality of what our community needs in terms of coming to faith. Okay, have a think about that. You know, we have ways of thinking, and we think our community needs this or that, and we need to present this or that to our community in terms of coming to faith. Unless we are actually in the community and know what their needs are, how do we know whether our mind map matches the reality? As in the story there, we could be completely off the track. As in the story, there had been a seismic shift in society. Okay, in the story there, it was earthquakes and landslips and mudslides and whatever. We have had, just have, and are still having a seismic shift in our society. It's called COVID-19. And this means that reality is now extremely different to what it was even a couple of years ago. So, what's the challenge? And this is where we come back to the scripture reading that was read by Odette this morning, thank you, that we need to take a leaf out of the Apostle Paul's book and start thinking about how we can be a bit more of the all things to all people. It is possible that people are searching, and I'm sure they are searching out there. But the question is, are they searching for the things that we think they're searching for, or in the way that we think they're searching? Maybe they're not. Perhaps, just perhaps, it's time to ditch the map, in quotes, and look at what is actually going on around us and what people are really searching for. I'm going to conclude my message this morning by taking you to a parable that Jesus told. And this is a parable that he told in Matthew 22, all about the wedding banquet. And if you remember, he invited many, many people, but they didn't accept his invitation, did they? So if I take just a couple of verses out of that, from I'm reading verse 8 to verse 10, the king says, he said to his servants, the wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find. So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. I want you to note here that the servants, the king and the servants, did not sit and wait for the banquet hall to be filled. The servants were instructed to go out and to get the people in, to come into the banquet. And that is the instruction that our master gives to us, that we should go out and find the people, the bad and the good. It doesn't matter where they are, what estate they live on, what their background is. He wants us to go and find them, because otherwise, wherever we want to call our groups, whether it's a church building, whether it's a house group, whether it's another informal meeting group, that they will be empty. We will not find these people, but we need to go and find them and find out what they're looking for. So because they won't come unless they are invited. And like I said, it's not just about offering the invitation. We need to invite them in a way which is relevant to their needs. Not what we think they need, but what they need. And so my prayer for this morning is threefold. Firstly, that God would help us to be as far as possible all things to all people around our communities, but particularly around where we meet for church. Number two, that God would grant us his Holy Spirit to give us power and boldness, and to give us the words to speak and the mind to think differently beyond our current mind maps. And thirdly, in so doing, may we be able to think outside our own little boxes and more inside God's very own big and creative box. Amen. We're going to sing one final song together, and it's all about being an encouragement to reach out to the people in need, not just with their community needs, but also with God's salvation. We're going to sing Beauty for Brokenness, and I know that's one of Justine's favourites as well. So let's get ready to sing that now, shall we?
Let's pray together, shall we? Father God, this song kind of says a lot, really. Help us to be willing to go out to meet the poor and the needy where they are, but not just to meet their physical needs, but to help us to be able to bring them your salvation, so that they too may come and be a part of your family, that they too may be able to praise your name, and that we can all be a much bigger family. Help us in our daily lives to be able to make disciples. Give us your power, give us the presence of your Spirit, direct us to people that we can make a difference to in our lives. And may your wedding banquet hall be filled with people who have chosen to accept you. And maybe we might have had just a little part in making that possible. And so we pray now for your presence and your power as we go from this place. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I've got a sign shining through here. Thank you very much, Mike and the family. And thank you to all our other helpers as well. Thank you to our visiting friends who came today. We pray that you are blessed. We are not shutting down the Zoom channel yet, so we can hang around and fellowship. But thank you all, helpers. God bless you.